Going to study particularly Romans chapter 10 and verse number 4. Shall we stand up as we read this in unison? Romans 10:4, ready, read. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. Father, we thank you for once again giving us this opportunity to gather and study your word. I pray, Lord, that you will forgive us of our sins, that we may be worthy, O God, of the truth that we will learn today from your word. I pray that you will give me wisdom, Lord, that this may be taught in a way that will glorify you in a biblical way, in a way, Lord, that will make us increase in knowledge and wisdom. And I am praying, Lord, for grace that we may also be able to proclaim this so that we'll be able to help other people know these things. I pray, Lord, as your people listen, that you will give them understanding and attentiveness, Lord, that we may benefit through this study. May you be glorified in everything that we will do today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. May be seated. Thank you very much. So Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. If you're going to look at the interpretation of this, or how people look at the definition or meaning of Romans chapter 10 and verse number 4, you will see that there are several explanation or school of thoughts regarding this. Some claim that after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Sabbath was changed to the first day of the week. That is why they are saying that because of the resurrection of Jesus, now the Sabbath is Sunday. And that is the reason why Christians or followers of the Lord are worshiping on Sunday. And then, yet there is another view that is being held by the Seventh-day Adventists, is that the moral law or the Ten Commandments have never been done away. Yes, there are laws that are not in effect today in our time. They may have something to do with ceremonial laws and laws about food and these things. But they will contend that moral law is still in effect. And therefore, if the moral law or the Ten Commandments is still in effect and Sabbath is a part of that law, therefore, Sabbath is still enforced today. That is why they worship on Saturday, because that is what they believe. That's why they're called the Seventh-day Adventists. And then another view is set forth that after the resurrection of Christ, the law, including the Sabbath, was fulfilled by Jesus Christ. That's why they are quoting Romans chapter 10, verse number 4. They maintain that the law was given only to Israel and was only a shadow of future things to come. Meaning to say that now that the Lord Jesus Christ came and have gone and will come again, the substance already arrived, and therefore we should do away with what we call the type, because the anti-type already fulfilled that particular typology. So these are basically the three beliefs or points that are being held regarding Seventh Day and the law in connection with Romans chapter 10 and verse number 4. So let us look at the Word of God and see what the Word of God is actually teaching us regarding Romans 10:4 in connection with Sabbath and the law that is mentioned in the Bible, or particularly in the Old Testament. So first, let us look at the meaning of the word Sabbath. What does this word mean? The word Sabbath appears for the first time in the Bible in Exodus chapter 16 and verse number 23. If we are going to apply the law of first mention, this will set the precedence from all the succeeding how we should treat the word Sabbath after it was first mentioned in Exodus 16:23. The Bible says, "And he said unto them, this is that which the Lord that said, tomorrow is the rest of the holy Sabbath unto the Lord. Bake that which ye will bake today, and see it that ye will see it, and that which remaineth overlay up for you to be kept until the morning." So that was the first mention of the word Sabbath, and you will see that in this first mention there is that implied meaning or expressed meaning that it will be a day of rest. Meaning to say, it means that you must stop from your work. The word Sabbath means to stop, to cease what you are doing, or to take an intermission from your labor and activities. Now, the word Sabbath is not actually translated in English. It was transliterated. The Hebrew word for Sabbath is Shabbat, and the Greek word is Sabbaton. And both are brought over into English untranslated. Like, for example, baptism. It is a transliteration. The Greek word of baptism is baptizo. And then it was transliterated into baptism. So it is not actually a translation of the word, but a transliteration. So in the Ten Commandments, or Exodus chapter 20, verse number 8, we will see here that the Bible says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. If we will apply the transliteration, it will be read like this. Remember the rest day and keep it holy. So that will be the how you are going to read it if we are going to translate the word Sabbath into English. It will be remember the rest day and keep it holy, because Sabbath means rest. Now, in the Old Testament, the word Sabbath is used approximately 75 times. That is more or less 75 times. And in 35 cases, it is in reference to the ceremonial Sabbath day. And the other 40 has reference to the weekly Sabbath on the seventh day. So 40 times it was used referring to the weekly Sabbath, or the rest day, or Saturday. And then 35 times it refers to the ceremonial Sabbath. Because there are ceremonial Sabbath. Every feast in Israel is commemorated with Sabbath. For example, the beginning, or at the beginning and at the end of the feast. So 75 times it was used. But we also need to understand that in the New Testament, the word Sabbath occurs over 60 times, but never appears again after Acts chapter 18 and verse number 4. It in the book of Acts. After that, it was not mentioned anymore. So there must be something happened that it stopped. Something happens that it is not in effect anymore, or they are not, or they did not use that word anymore. Now, in order to understand this better, we need to understand that there are many different Sabbaths. There's not only one kind of Sabbath. Of course, it's rest day. But there are many different kinds of Sabbath that was given by God to the Israelites. As I have said, one category is that it was a rest day, weekly rest day. But the other category is it is contained in what we call the ceremonial laws. So we can say this, that all Saturday is Sabbath. Or all seventh day is Sabbath, but not all Sabbaths are seventh day or Saturday. So we will see that as we read several verses. Let us look at Leviticus chapter 23, verses 24 and 25. Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month. So that's very clear. That's the first day of the month. That first day of the month can fall on any day, on any given year. Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month, shall ye have a Sabbath, a memorial of blowing of trumpets, and holy convocation. Ye shall do no servile work therein, because it's rest. But ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord, because it has something with ceremonies or feasts in Israel. So we can see that this can fall on any day than the seventh day or Saturday. And then we will also see that is the feast of the trumpets. And then we will also see at the Day of Atonement in Leviticus chapter 16, verses 29 and 31. And this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, again, it can fall on any day, on any given year, ye shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether it be one of your own country or a stranger that sojourneth among you. It shall be a Sabbath of rest unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls by a statute forever. So this is the Day of Atonement. And again, there is a Sabbath day that may not fall on the seventh day or a Saturday. And then in Leviticus chapter 23, verses 27 to 32, this concerns the same feast. Also on the tenth day of the seventh month, there shall be a Day of Atonement. It shall be an holy convocation unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls and offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. And ye shall do no work in that same day, for it is a Day of Atonement, to make an atonement for you before the Lord your God. For whatsoever soul it be that shall not be afflicted in that same day, he shall be cut off from among his people. So there is a capital punishment here. Pakituloy hanggang hanggang 32. Ye shall do no manner of work. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations in all your dwellings. It shall be unto you a Sabbath of rest, and ye shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the month. At even, from even unto even, shall ye celebrate your Sabbath. So there are Sabbaths that are not on the seventh day. These are Sabbaths, as I have said, that have something to do with the feasts or ceremonies given by God to Israel. And then also in the feast of the Passover, mentioned in Leviticus chapter 23, verse number 7. In the first day ye shall have an holy convocation, ye shall do no servile work therein. So this is concerning the feast of the Passover. And then the feast of the Pentecost in chapter 23, verse number 21 of Leviticus. And ye shall proclaim on that selfsame day that it may be an holy convocation unto you, ye shall do no servile work therein. It shall be a statute forever in all your dwellings throughout your generation. And we can read many other verses regarding these things. But so far, what we can find is this, that God had given many Sabbaths besides just the seventh day or the weekly Sabbath to the nation of Israel. The truth of the matter is that there is even a Sabbath for the land given by God to Israel in Leviticus chapter 25, 1 to 4. And the Lord spake unto Moses in Mount Sinai, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, When ye come into the land which I give you, then shall the land keep a Sabbath unto the Lord. 6 years thou shalt sow thy field, and 6 years thou shalt prune thy vineyard, and gather in the fruit thereof. But in the seventh year shall be a Sabbath of rest unto the land, a Sabbath for the Lord. Thou shalt neither sow thy field nor prune thy vineyard. So there is a whole year of rest for the land. Therefore, the farmers won't be able to do anything to the land on that 7 year. And then suffice it to say that there is also what you call the Jubilee. It is also a whole year Sabbath for the people of Israel. So there are many Sabbaths given to them. But we can easily determine by the context which Sabbath the Lord is referring to. But one thing also that we have to understand is that all Sabbaths were pertaining to rest. Rest day or 1 year, rest for the land, or for the time of Jubilee, there are provisions there that they cannot do anything because it was the purpose why God had given to them the Sabbath. So rest day, including the Sabbath of the land, the seventh day, and the ceremonial Sabbath. So there is not only one kind of Sabbath, because most of the time, especially when I was teaching in Bible school in the Philippines, the subject of cults, when it comes to Sabbath, the first thing and maybe the only thing that will come into the mind of people is the seventh day or Saturday. So that's why for them, only Saturday is the Sabbath day. They do not understand that as God has given Sabbaths to Israel, He gave many, several kinds of Sabbath. But one thing is in common, it is a day of rest. So it has something to do with resting or stopping or ceasing from our work. So if we will go now to Exodus chapter 20, and if we are going to look at the fourth commandment in Exodus 20 verses 8 to 10, this is what we will read. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord, thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gate. So what is it that we can get from this? Very simple. Sabbath day is rest day. Nobody is allowed to work, including everybody that is within thy gates. You cannot even ask your maid, your manservant, or your maid servant to work because it is rest day given by the Lord. And then, if you will proceed and go to verse number 11. For in 6 days, the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. So we can see that this was a principle laid down by God in the Garden of Eden after the creation, but it was not given to man until 2,500 years later. So it was a principle laid in Genesis during the creation, in Genesis chapter 2 verses 1 to 3, but then it was not given to man. Not until after 2,500 years. So the principle of one day in seven for rest was laid down in the mind of God only, as I have said, during the creation, and was not given to man until 2,500 years later That's why there is no record that Adam, Abel, Seth, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob ever obeying the Sabbath. There was no record of that. You cannot see that Jacob rested on the seventh day, that Abraham did that, that Adam did that, or anybody else, until it was given by God to Moses at Mount Sinai as a law to the people of Israel, or one of God's covenant to the people of Israel. So it only happened after Israel was liberated from Egypt, and after Moses received the law, that Sabbath appeared as a commandment. That is the reason why, even before Moses received this law, Moses did not observe Sabbath, or what we call the rest day on the seventh day of the week. So it was first mentioned, as I have said, in Exodus chapter 16. And we will continue to read there, verses 26, 29, and 30. Can we go there, Milka? Exodus 16. 6 days she shall gather it, but on the seventh day, which is the Sabbath, in it there shall be none. And it came to pass that there went out some of the people on the seventh day for to gather, and they found none. This is in reference with the manna. And the Lord said unto Moses, how long refuse ye to keep my commandments and my laws? See, for that the Lord hath given you the Sabbath, therefore he giveth you on the sixth day the bread of 2 days. Abide ye every man in his place. Let no man go out of his place on the seventh day. So the people rested on the seventh day. So that's the Sabbath. It is a complete rest day. Rest for the people of Israel. So far there are two things that are evident in what we have read so far. This commandment was given only to the nation of Israel through Moses. It was never given to any Gentile nation. Only to Israel. That's why every time the word Sabbath is mentioned, it has something to do with Israel and not with the Gentiles. And the number two, it was a complete day of rest, and no person was ever to leave their dwelling place. So why is it that during the ceremonial Sabbath? Well, because that is a feast. It is a command. It is not the weekly Sabbath. But they cease from their work during a Sabbath that is connected with ceremonies or feasts given to Israel. So the difference between the weekly Sabbath and the feast Sabbath is that a weekly Sabbath is a complete rest. They are not even allowed to go out of their houses. But during the ceremonial Sabbath, they will stop from their regular work, but they're going to obey the commandment of the Lord regarding those things that are associated in keeping the feast in Israel. You understand that? So that is why, do not be confused when the seventh day will tell you, or the cows will tell you that, oh, look at this, this is Sabbath day, but they are worshiping. They're offering. They're doing something. That is not a weekly Sabbath. That is not the regular weekly Sabbath. Because the regular weekly Sabbath is simply a rest day for Israel. And they are not allowed to do anything on that day. Actually, simply picking up a stick will cost you your life if you will do that on the Sabbath day. So for those who believe or teach or maintain that we are to worship on Saturday, the Sabbath day, we can actually find just the opposite in the Bible. It is a day of rest. It is not a day of worship unless it is connected with the feast given by God to Israel. So no religious work should be done on that day in a public manner during the weekly Sabbath. Again, I will reiterate this, and the Bible reiterated this in Leviticus chapter 16, verse 29. And this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month, no, is that, I don't think that's the right, no, in Exodus, I'm sorry, chapter 20, verses 9, 10, and 11. We actually read this a while ago, that it was reiterated that Sabbath is simply a day of rest. Weekly Sabbath, it is not a day of worship. So if the Seventh-day Adventists and other, I don't know if there are other groups that maintain that worship day should be Saturday or the seventh day, then they are actually disobeying the command given by the Lord to Israel. Actually, they cannot disobey it because it was not a command given to them. So Seventh-day Adventists who worship on a Saturday is not disobeying the command of the Lord, because in the first place, it was not given to them. You cannot disobey what was not given to you. So they are simply trying to put themselves into something or to obey a command that was not even given to them by God. Because in order for you to obey the law of the Sabbath, then you must be a Jew. And because Seventh-day Adventists are not Jews, therefore, they are not given this command. And therefore, we cannot technically accuse them of breaking the law of the Sabbath because it was not given to them. Another thing that we need to notice is this. There is a capital punishment when you disobey the law of the Sabbath. So we cannot kill them if they disobey the law of the Sabbath. Why? Because as I have said, they cannot disobey it. It was not given to them. We cannot also stone them to death because the law was also not given to us. So what's happening is that they are teaching something that is not applicable in this dispensation, and we are trying to refute them or to fight against them regarding this, wherein we ourselves should not be a part of it, except that we are teaching them what the Bible is actually teaching. Because sometimes when we talk with the Seventh-day Adventists, we try to include ourselves and tell them that we are not a part of it, trying to alienate them that they are actually a part of it by telling them that if you really believe and really obeying the Sabbath day, then how many people have you stoned to death? Since there are provisions on the Sabbath that you have disobeyed. Well, they cannot disobey something that was not given to them. So that is why this is something that we need to understand. So the thing is that people must listen to the Bible than just the teaching of the church. Yes, we have our teaching here, but we must see to it that what we are teaching in this church is something or things that are only written in the Word of God. Because whatever we teach in this church that is not sanctioned by the Bible is not true, and it should not be enforced in our church or in with our people. What we need to listen and to take heed is what was written in Psalms 118, verse 8. This is what the Bible says. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. You see, the sad thing is that many leaders of religion are being obeyed, being worshipped, and whatever they say, the people under them believe that it is true or it is even from the Lord. But we need to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. If that man is obeying or teaching the Word of God, then that's the time that we are going to believe or even to follow that man. When the Apostle Paul says, follow me as I follow Christ. That is the only way that we can put confidence or trust in man. Look at Jeremiah chapter 17, verse number 5. Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man, and maketh his flesh his arm, and whose heart departed from the Lord. So if any man's heart, or any person who is departed from the Lord, or is trusting in himself, or any other thing, or people in this world, than God, then we should not follow that man. We should not trust that man. Why? Because we will be cursed. That is why when you are manipulated by people, then you will find yourself in a hard place. Why? Because it is not God's word. It is not God's command. It is only the whim and caprice of a person who believes in themselves and in other things than God. So, now, what is the law? So we have already determined what is Sabbath. Now, the next question is, what is the law? Because many people have the mistaken notion that the law of the Old Testament only refers to the Ten Commandments. When I was a Catholic, when they say the law, the first thing that will come into my mind, and maybe the only thing that will come into my mind, is the Ten Commandments. So that is why this is a common misconception of those people who do not know the Word of God or who are not reading the Bible. Actually, the word law is used in reference to the entire law. Usually, when you see the word law, it is used in reference to the entire law. Now, the law includes the moral laws and the civil laws and the ceremonial laws. And it was given only, again, to the nation of Israel. And if we're going to look at these different laws, they will approximate to about 720 laws under the caption, the law. So I doubt if many Israelites would memorize this. That's why, if you will look at the Old Testament, Moses keeps on reminding them again and again and again and again. Why? Because people tend to forget. And it's very hard to memorize 720 laws and know it by heart. And then sometimes you will find the word law is in reference actually to the Ten Commandments or the tables of the stone. But this is always made clear by the context. That is why when you see the word law, you look at the context so that you will determine if it is referring to the Ten Commandments, the moral law, the civil law, the ceremonial law, or the law as a whole. And then we will know what that word is referring to. Okay, example, in 1 Corinthians 9:9, there is a quotation here that the Apostle Paul used. For it is written in the law of Moses. Usually when they say the law of Moses, Ten Commandments. But it says, for it is written in the law of Moses, thou shalt not muzzle the mouth of the ox that treadeth out the corn, that God take care for oxen. So this is a quotation by the Apostle Paul. But this obviously is not part of the Ten Commandments. But it is a part of the law given by God to Moses. And it is actually Deuteronomy chapter 25 and verse number 4. Thou shalt not muzzle the ox when he treadeth out the corn. So it is part of what we call the civil law. So that's why we need to look at the context or compare scripture with scripture to find out what kind of law is being mentioned. If it is part of the Ten Commandments, if it is moral law, if it is civil law, or if it is ceremonial law. But then there is a teaching in the Bible that is very clear that unless a person keeps the whole law, All 720 of them, the Bible says in Galatians chapter 3 verse 10, that they are cursed under the law. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. So that is very clear. That is why if you say that you're still under the law, you're cursed. You're doomed. You're already condemned. Why? You cannot continue on this 720 of them. Even if they ask you to recite 720 of them, you may not be able to do that. And not only that, if you break even one of the 720 laws, you are already guilty of all. So it is all or nothing. That is the law, what the law demands. Why? Because the law reflects the holiness and perfection of God. And no man can achieve that. The Bible says we fell short of the glory of God. And this law reflects the perfection of God that no man can ever achieve. So you might say that Galatians 3:10 is a quotation just from the New Testament. Actually, it came from the Old Testament also. It is found in Deuteronomy 27:26. Cursed be he that confirm not all the words of this law to do them, and all the people shall say, Amen. So that is the law. It is not only the Ten Commandments, but it includes moral law, civil law, and ceremonial law. So now the question is this. Why is it that Seventh-day Adventists and other people are contending that the Sabbath was changed to Sunday? You see, the Sabbath has never been changed. There is not one verse in the Bible that will substantiate a change of the weekly Sabbath. It was always on the seventh day of the week. That is the weekly Sabbath. Or it is always associated with the feast of Israel. So to say that Sunday is now the Sabbath is not found in the scripture. There are Baptists or people will say that Sunday is our Sabbath. In a way, it is partly correct because we should not be working on Sunday. We should stop working on Sunday. But we worship on a Sunday, so therefore it is not entirely correct. We do not worship on Sunday because it was the new Sabbath. No. We worship on a Sunday to commemorate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is what the apostles and the early church did. So that's why after, as I have said, Acts chapter 18, verse number 4, you will not find, actually, I do not even remember that a church will gather on the Sabbath day except during the early stage when they are gathering together every day from house to house. But if there is a gathering, it is always on the first day of the week. Like one example is 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 1 and 2. This is where they gather. 16, 1 and 2. Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given order to the churches of Galatia, so many churches are doing this, even so do ye. Upon the first day of the week, let everyone of you lay by him in store, as God hath prospered him, that there be no gatherings when I come. So why first day of the week? Because this is the day that they usually gather. And it will be easier to collect this collection for the saints or help for the Christian in Israel or suffering a severe drought during this time to get that collection so that it can be sent to them and help them. Because they usually gather, the church gather on the first day of the week. So when we read in Romans 10:4, for Christ is the end of the law, for righteousness to everyone that believeth, it means that Christ's payment on the cross and his resurrection ended the law. Meaning to say, even if Israel was given this law, when they believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, and they got saved, they are no longer under the law. It has no more effect on them. It's not effective on them anymore. They are now freed from that law. That law ended the moment a person or even a Jew accept the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. So this includes the whole law, moral, civil, and ceremonial. Now there is a question. So because even the moral law is not in effect anymore, so therefore we can do whatever we want to do. Of course not. Grace is not a license to sin. It is not a license that because I'm now a Christian and I'm not under the law, I'm going to be lawless. No. Not being under the law does not mean that we are going to be lawless. There is a greater, actually, position that we are now in, and that is we are under grace. And grace is unmerited favor, and therefore, as a person who is under grace, created unto good works, then it behooves us to do good in the sight of God for mankind. So that is where we are now. So there is now no moral obligation given to us. Of course, there are moral obligations given to us. Actually, the truth of the matter is that our moral obligation is even greater than what the Ten Commandments or the moral law in the Old Testament asked the Israelites to do. The truth is that 9 out of the 10 commandments were repeated in the New Testament except commandment number 4. Except the word Sabbath. If you are taking notes, we will just do it quick. Okay, the first command is, thou shalt have no other gods before me. And then in John chapter 4, 21 to 23. Just take a note of this verse. 1 Timothy 2:5. James chapter 2, verse 19. 1 Corinthians 8:6, you will see that this particular command were all reflected in these verses. And then the second, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, in Exodus chapter 20, verse number 7. Then in the New Testament, James chapter 5, verse number 12. Matthew chapter 5, verses 33 to 37. And then Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 to 9. And then commandment in Exodus chapter 20, verse number 4, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Now connect that to Acts chapter 17, 29. Romans 1, 22 to 23. 1 John chapter 5, 21. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 7 to 14. Honor thy father and mother. Exodus 20:12. Connect that to Ephesians chapter 6, 1 to 4. That's very clear. Memorize to nila, ano? Nila chut-chut. And then thou shalt not kill. Exodus chapter 20, verse 13. Connect that to Matthew chapter 5, 21 to 22. And Romans 13, 9. I'm not giving all the references, only some. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Exodus chapter 20, verse number 14. Connect that to Matthew chapter 5, 27 to 28. 1 Corinthians 5, 1 to 13. This is comprehensive even. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 to 20. Hebrews 13, 4. Romans 13, 9. Actually, in the Old Testament, you must do the act in order to be considered an adulterer. But in the New Testament, just looking lustfully against an opposite sex is already an adultery. And then hating your brother is already a murder. And then, thou shalt not bear false witness. Colossians, connect that to Colossians chapter 2, verse number 9. And Ephesians chapter 4:25 and Romans 13:9. Thou shalt not covet. Exodus 20:17. Connect that to Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 3. Luke 12:55. No, 15 to 21, I'm sorry. And Romans 13:9. And then, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Connect it to none. There is no mention in the Old Testament given by Jesus, by God or the apostles of the Christian, that we need to keep the Sabbath. That we need to remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. So for those people that want to be justified by the law, remember, you must keep all of God's law absolutely perfect. The problem is this. So many cults are trying to impose the law, but they do not want the penalty of the law. Capital punishment. They do not want that. But they said that the only way for us to be justified is to have faith plus works. And we need to obey the law. But when they disobey the law, they do not want the punishment that is associated with that law. Always remember, in James chapter 2, verse 10, the Bible says, for whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. You see, just like in the Philippines, when you commit a crime, it says, people of the Philippines versus Rilson Tinga. Why? Because it is the law of the land. And when you disobey, you are going against the entire country or the entire people of that country. That is why we need to understand that we are no longer under this law. And actually, nobody should be under this law if they will only repent of their sins and accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. Because the law can only condemn. The law cannot justify, because there is nobody that can keep the whole law except the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, some people may ask, why is it that the Lord Jesus Christ kept the Sabbath? Well, because when the Lord Jesus Christ came here on earth, he was made, or he came here under the law. Look at Galatians chapter 4, I believe, verses 1 to 4. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, deferreth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Even so, when we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the law. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law. Jesus Christ was a Jew. He was made under the law. He came under the law. So he keeps the law. He kept the law. And that is why he qualified as our Savior, because he fulfilled the requirement of the law. That's why he is the only Savior there is, and the only mediator between God and man. He fulfilled the type in the Old Testament, especially the lamb, without blemish, perfect, offered for the atonement of the sin of Israel. But his offering, unlike the Day of Atonement, is done every year. But the offering of the Lord Jesus Christ was done once and for all. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 10 to 14. By the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest standeth daily and ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. It can only cover. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God. From henceforth, expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering, he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. So that is why we are no longer under this law. And even the people that are trying to say that this law is still effective and should be enforced, as I have said a while ago, are not even willing to receive the punishment for breaking the law. So that is why the Christian has no relationship with the law in the Old Testament anymore. Why? The law is our school master, pointing us to the Savior, and because we are now in the Savior, we do not need the schoolmaster. Because the schoolmaster already fulfilled his purpose in our lives. And that is to make us realize that we are sinners, that we cannot save ourselves, that there is one person who can save us, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. So when that thing happened, then the law has ended. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. Why? Because when we believe Jesus, his righteousness was imputed unto us. And therefore, we are no longer under that law because we already have the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. So salvation is therefore becomes a matter of being justified by grace. That is Mount Calvary, or by law. That is Mount Sinai. And Mount Sinai was not given to save us, but the Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross, was buried, and resurrected that we may be justified. Look at Galatians chapter 2, verse number 16. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law. That is very clear, amen? But by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. So we are saved by the faith or the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not our own doing, not our work. So therefore, we are no longer under that law because Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. And as I have said a while ago, this refers to the whole law. And we are no longer under this law. So the reason why we need to know this and understand this is so that whenever we talk to people, especially the Seventh-day Adventists and other people who believe the same, that we can explain to them that even though the Ten Commandments is no longer in effect, we can still show them that the moral law given by God to Israel, even though we are not no longer under it, there is a law. Or a life that we should live and guided by the morals given to us by the Lord Jesus Christ. So when we say it ended, Because it refers to Israel. But those that were given to us belongs to us. As I've said, like for example, the law against adultery in Israel is very clear. You must be caught in the act in order to be judged as an adulterer, and you will be stoned to death. But in, under grace, just looking at an opposite sex lustfully, already constituted adultery. And there's also spiritual adultery. When we put other things or other people first before God. But when Romans 10:4 says that Christ is the end of the law, it means that we are no longer under the law, and we cannot cite those verses given by God to Israel and apply that to us. There may be principles that we can apply, but we cannot apply specifically and technically the law, because those laws has what we call punishment associated with it. And we cannot just choose or pick what we want to apply and those things that we do not want to apply. Like the first fruits offering. They just pick it and apply it. But they do away with the burnt offering. They do away with the peace offering. They do away with the jealousy offering. They do away with many offerings, but because this will benefit them, then they will all of a sudden apply it. And then they are going to pick up a tithing, and then they will apply it, and they will tell you, if you're not giving 10% of your income, then you are a robber. And you are cursed. But we are no longer under the curse, because Christ is the end of the law. And if you believe in Jesus, look at Galatians 3:13. Christ hath not redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. The Lord Jesus Christ already redeemed us from the curse. So, no, pastor has the right to say that because you're not giving 10% of your income, then you are under a curse. No, that is for Israel. That is not for us. Even tithing is not given to the Christians. Our offering is free will. Whatever you want to give. So, pastor, why is it that it becomes an issue when, for example, I am receiving $1,000 a month and I only want to give $1? That is the desire of my heart. Is something wrong? Well, everything is wrong. Why? Because you are not growing as a Christian. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not saying that because you gave $1, you are not right with God. No, I'm not saying that. A new Christian, a babe in Christ, may not understand so many things about the Bible, about the church, about the work that we are doing, about the calling that we have, about the responsibility given to us by God. That is understandable. But as your faith grows and you understand that we need to preach the gospel to every creature, and you understand that we need to reach our own Jerusalem to Christ, and then Judea, and then Samaria, and then the uttermost part of the earth, and you will understand that it needs money in order for this to accomplish, and you will understand that you are here temporarily, and you must set your affection on things above, not on the things on earth. And the only thing that matters are the things that we do that has eternity in view. Then you will understand that you should not keep your treasure here on earth or lay up treasures on earth, but lay up treasures in heaven. And one way of doing that is reaching the lost by giving what is reasonable, practical, and biblical in order for the church to accomplish this purpose. That's why some person may not understand when I said something like this. You see, we went under this pandemic for now 9 months, I believe, right? But 7 months, when it started, all of us lose their jobs. Stoppage of work. Nobody's working. Some people sacrifice in order to help the church go through this. And I appreciate that. God appreciate that. And it can only happen because God put that in their heart. And then the church actually fed most of us for 7 months because of the money that the church was able to save. And some of the money that came in as help from other brethren in the Lord. So we were able to survive 7 months. And then there were 2 months of work, job. And all of you receive your income. And then one did not even give an offering after receiving an income. But that one received 7 months of relief from the church. Now, will the finances of the church be affected because of that one? No. God is faithful. God will provide. This is what I'm telling you. Even if you will not give, God will use somebody so that the work will continue. But the question is, why not you? Why somebody else? You understand what I'm saying? You see, there are those who were members of churches in the Philippines before they came here. Can you raise up your hand? You know the pressure every Sunday that you hear from the pastors. I'm not exaggerating. This can be proven by those who raised their hand. Maybe not even one preaching since the day that you attended the church that there was no mention of giving in the church. You were judged time and time again that because you did not give your 10%, you're a robber. And you should be ashamed of yourself. That you're under a curse, etc., etc. But in our church, we do not pressure people to give. It is according to the desire of your heart. But if your heart is growing, you see, a matured Christian should not be told what to do. Amen? They know what to do. And then even after telling the principle or even the truth to that person, he or she will still continue that. Brothers and sisters, we are in this together. If one is hurting, everybody is hurting. If one is rejoicing, everybody will be rejoicing. And in order for this church to be successful in the sight of God, we may just be a handful, but what is important is that we understand our roles, our responsibilities in the Lord, and we will do that by the grace of God. And once we did that, then at least in the sight of God, we're okay. You understand what I'm saying? So that's why sometimes I am saying these things, not because I need your money. No. The truth is that I am a missionary. I receive support from different churches. I do not get money from the church. So there is no reason for me to ask the church that we may save much money so that I can use it for the things that will benefit myself. No. It's not even that. But the point is this. We need to grow. And if we are growing, it will be reflected in our life. Not only in our giving. Giving is only one barometer or thermometer of that. But what's important is that we are growing in the Lord. As you will see, as we are going through the book of Hebrews, I don't know if it was already mentioned that we need to live the principles of these basic things, and we need to go on to unto maturity. Because the Lord cannot use us if we are not going to become mature, amen? So I hope and I pray that this will be able to help us think things through, pray to the Lord, and ask God. Brothers and sisters, don't worry. You remember the preaching? Don't worry. God knows what we need. Let us just be faithful and God will provide for what we need. Because if that will not happen, then our God is not a faithful God. So we have to be faithful to Him because He is always faithful to us. Amen? Shall we stand up? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the Sunday school.